Palm Sunday on the hill this morning. It's good to see everybody. There seems like this time of year there's a little bit of excitement in the air. And that's a good thing, you know, celebrating Christ's triumphal entry today into Jerusalem. And what a week this will be, amen. An uncertain week for many followers during that time, but we know the end of the story, don't we? Amen. So we celebrate this week the risen Savior this week. So it is exciting. Let's all stand to our feet this morning. We've got a big day here. These kids are just, I know they're anxious and ready to get up here. And so we're looking forward to that as well. But let's start this morning with a word of prayer. And I'll ask Brother Sammy Toler, if he will, to lead us in prayer this morning as we begin our service.
Our Father and our God, we come to you with a grateful heart. Father, we thank you for this day of life and this morning. Father, we thank you for the privilege you give us to be able to come here for the night. Father, we want to be where you have to be. We ask you to just be in our midst, Father, Holy Spirit, have the free reign to your Father, everything you said to us, for our glorified to you. We ask you to be with us. We don't make this morning, Father, to be so difficult. We ask you to be with us. You help them, that this Father will be God of us. You bring all that world back to us. We confess to the Father, and the Father will be the foundation of work and deeds. I pray you, a lot of people say, that the truth has to be the truth. Father, you bless us, we have all the people, the people, the people, the people, the body, the people, the people, the people, the people, the people, the people, the people,
amen. Let's join in singing a chorus this morning. If you turn in your books, it's on page 38. The words will be on the screen too. Isn't he wonderful? Who can say amen to that? Amen. Hey, let's sing that together this morning.
This morning, but first of all, I want to welcome all of you here this morning. If you're visiting with us, well, we give that a privilege this morning, and thank you for coming to worship the Lord with us this morning. We have announcements today. We have a bridal shower over the fellowship hall from 2 to 4 today for Caitlin Mathis. This has been an Amy Stinnett's daughter, so come out and be a part of that. We are not going to have services here Martin Hill tonight. We are going to cancel those services and go to Oakland Baptist Church. They're having their passion play up there. We're going to support one of our very own, Miss Savannah Hysoff. Savannah, raise your hand. She's participating in that program, and we want to go up and be a part of that and support her. If you'd like to go with the church, we'll be leaving here at 5:30. The program begins at 7, correct? All right. So if you want to be a part of that, please be here for that. Good Friday service on Friday evening, March 29th, down at the tomb, beginning about 6 o'clock. Bring your volunteers. We're going to set out down by the tomb. Brother Terry Booker, one of our former pastors, will be preaching that service Friday night. And then after that service, all the senior saints that would like to will go down to Omar's around 7 o'clock, and we'll have a meal and some fellowship time with Brother Terry Booker. I also want to let everybody know that they will not be serving a meal Wednesday night. They've got a lot going on this week, so we're not going to serve a meal against tonight. Then on March the 30th, Saturday morning, there'll be an Easter egg hunt here at the church at 10 o'clock for 0 to 6 to the 6th grade. So come out, all you young people, and hunt eggs and enjoy that time Saturday morning. And then Sunday morning, beginning at 7 o'clock, we hope to be able to do it down at the tomb if the weather lets us. We'll be having our Easter sunrise service at 7 o'clock Sunday morning. And then immediately following that, at the fellowship hall, we will have our breakfast. And then we will have, after breakfast, of course, we'll have our regular Sunday school and worship service. And then we'll be casting next Sunday night, as we usually do on Easter. This morning, I also want to let you know that on April the 1st, we'll have our Men of God meeting at 6:30, and we have a special guest speaker coming for that. Before we move forward with the offering and things this morning, we've got a special presentation for Brother Ace. Brother Ace, come up here, man. He's got Kyle off guard here. Man. I understand that this young man is going to have a birthday. You're going to be 22 years old, and I heard you find out you got the same birthday as Jerry Croft. Jerry, you're going to be 62.
Close enough.
You're getting old, Tommy. No, Jerry's getting old because he called yesterday and lost his wallet. We had to find his wallet for him. He owes me a steak supper.
I don't remember it now.
All right. So let's move into another time of worship during our service this morning. And that's our tithes and offering. We'll ask if you would, if you don't mind. I'd ask Brother Richard Shook if he would ask to bless and open the offering this morning.
Thank you for allowing me to be back today. I'm thankful for all
Meet and greet, if you got that offer, bring it up and put it in the back.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus. Yes, I know we're all in this hands, 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 yes, I know we're all in this hands. In his hands, he's got the little baby babies. In his hands, he's got the little baby babies. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the daddy
and the mama. In his hands, he's got the daddy and the mama. In his hands, he's got the daddy and the mama. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the new and big
water. In his hands, he's got the new and big water. In his hands, he's got the new and big water. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the whole world.
In his hands, he got the whole world. In his hands, he got the whole world. In his hands, he got the whole world in his hands.
Easter, the candy, the bunny, the baskets, coloring the eggs, and did I say candy?
Yes, you said candy, but you left out the best part of Easter, and that's the story.
The story of candy?
No, the story of Jesus.
I thought Christmas was the story of Jesus.
Well, it is. Christmas is the story of how Jesus was born, and Easter is the story of how he died. But the best part is that he rose again.
Yeah.
Okay, I know it has something to do with a cross and a grave, but I don't really understand it all.
I don't think I understand it either, but just knowing Jesus loved me enough to give his life for mine, it sure makes me want to live my life for him.
Get this straight. Jesus was punished even though he never did anything wrong, and he died so that we could live, but even though he died, he lives again.
You know what? I think you're starting to get it.
And you haven't even heard the best part yet.
You mean it gets better?
It does. The Bible tells us that if we believe in Jesus, we can live forever too.
No wonder we celebrate Easter.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the sun. Thank you. That thing's heavy. Wow, that was so good. Miss Dawn,
yes.
Thank you so very much. Listen, if you don't listen to me. Ever since I've been here, Miss Dawn has taken it on herself with help to do a fantastic job with our young people with programs and so forth. So if you don't have your children in church, I'm telling you, a good reason to have them here is because of these things, that they've been part of these things. And I'm telling you, this will impact them for all eternity. And so I want to encourage you to have your children in church, for sure. This morning, I'm going to try not to be too long, but you've heard that before, haven't you? Amen. I knew I was going to get an amen for that, but I'm still struggling with fluid on my ears, and everything sounds muffled to me. And so, please forgive me if I don't hear Howard say amen over there. Okay. Anyhow, I want to talk to you this morning about the king on the donkey. The king on the donkey, and. Oh, thank you, Mark.
I'm on now? Okay, the king on a donkey. And, of course, our Sunday school lesson was on this, what we call the triumphal entry into Jerusalem by Jesus. And that begins what we call Passion Week, the week before Jesus is crucified on Friday.
And so I'm going to be taking our scripture from Mark chapter 11, but I'm not going to read it. I'm just going to kind of tell it. And it's a Sunday. It's a Sunday. Jesus and his disciples are in Bethany. They've come there. They're about 2 miles from Jerusalem. And they are lodging with a fellow by the name of Lazarus and his wife Martha. That's where they are. You remember Lazarus, don't you? Lazarus is the guy that not too long back from this event, Jesus showed up at his grave, and he had been dead for 4 days. And Jesus showed up, and everybody was grieving and distraught. And Jesus walks up to the grave, and he says, "Lazarus." He tells the people, the guys, to roll the stone back, and they do. And he says, "Lazarus, come forth." You know that story. And Lazarus walked out of the grave, been dead for 4 days. And Jesus said, "Loosing, take off the grave clothes." And so that's who they're staying with. And it was a miracle that was certainly on the minds of people all around the area of Bethphage and Bethany, about 2 miles from actually Jerusalem. And so that was fresh on their minds. And here Jesus' disciples are there making their way to Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem, as he makes his way to Jerusalem, you understand that going there was very dangerous because the authorities are already trying to have him killed. He was already a marked man in a sense. But Jesus knows everything. Amen? He knows what he's doing, and he is marching headlong to crucifixion. He is going to the cross to die for the sins of the world. No doubt about it. And so Jesus is now on his way to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. It was a time of Passover, and you know what that was all about when they came together and celebrated the great deliverance from Egyptian bondage and the Passover lamb and all that. But Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. And he sends, in fact, I think we could take this a step further. He was not on his way to Jerusalem just to celebrate Passover. He was on his way to Jerusalem to be the Passover. He was going to die and become the Passover lamb that would die for the sins of the entire universe. And so he was actually going to be Passover. And he sends two of his disciples ahead of him and tells them there is a donkey tied up in a certain area around, I think, Bethphage there, and to go, and that there's going to be a donkey tied up. Go up and get that donkey. And this unridden, unbroken donkey, and bring him to me. And if anybody asks you, why are you taking the donkey, tell them that the Lord needs him. And of course, you know the rest of the story. Disciples, the two unnamed disciples, go there, and they are getting the donkey. And somebody says, "Why are you getting the donkey?" And they say, "The Lord has need of him." And so they bring the donkey back, and they put their clothes, their garments, some of their garments, as I was going to, on the donkey, and Jesus sits on the donkey, and he goes to Jerusalem on this donkey, and he gets to the outskirts of Jerusalem, and there the people are there, the multitude of people waiting on him to come, looking for a king, somebody that would overthrow the Roman government and siege the throne. And so they are there. They begin to put branches and leafy branches on the ground as he comes and shout, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And then Jesus goes to Jerusalem, doesn't give a long political speech, doesn't even give a speech, gets off the donkey, and it seems to suggest he goes into the temple, and he just kind of looks around and sees what's going on, and he really doesn't like what he's seeing, but he goes back to Bethany, and he spends the night there with Martha and Lazarus. And then the next day, which would have been Monday, he goes back, and that's when you have the cleansing of the temple that takes place. And so I just wanted to share that story with you from the Bible. And so I want you to see, what I want you to see this morning is I want you to see the significance of King Jesus on a donkey. Now it's hard to imagine the King of the universe riding a donkey. I picture in my mind, Jesus, when I picture Jesus as a king, I picture him riding on a stallion. In fact, he will when he comes back. We might talk about that another time. But I want you to see this morning, I want you to see the significance of King Jesus on a donkey. And I want you to see him, number one, and some of these points were actually covered in our Sunday school class this morning. My brother Mark did a magnificent job with that. But I want you to see him, first of all, as the prophetic king. You see, everything that is happening, when he rides in on that donkey, that is a fulfillment of prophecy. You know that? It had been prophesied. It had been prophesied by the prophet Zacharias. And Zacharias 9:9 says, "O rejoice, O people of Zion, shout and triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt." It's a fulfillment that was prophesied that this is going to happen, that the Messiah is going to ride in on a donkey to Jerusalem. It was prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years before it happened. Isn't that amazing? Did you know that there are at least 300 prophecies in the Old Testament about Jesus that have been were fulfilled in the New Testament? 300 prophecies fulfilled that were prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years before. Let me tell you today, the Bible continually proves itself over and over and over again. It is the truth. It is the real truth. The prophecies fulfilled by Jesus. It didn't happen by chance. It was God's design, and it happened like God laid it out. Hey, by the way, did you know God's still in control? Yeah, we look at the world, we think, my goodness, what's happening? Where's this all going? God's in control. God is in control. And so I want you to see, first of all, him as the prophetic king. But secondly, I want you to see him as the servant king. I want you to see him as the servant king. The Bible says the next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin." Well, that was John. Now, I want to back up just a minute from that. Mark 10:45 says, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many." Jesus came for the purpose of seeking and saving that which was lost. He came to serve humanity, not be served. And he taught us to do the same thing. Amen. And if you want to have a life of purpose, be a servant. Serve others. Be minister to others. But Jesus came as the servant king. Now, the donkey was known as a burden bearing animal, right? He was a burden-bearing animal because of his ability to carry heavy loads. And they were much used in Palestine during that time. In fact, they're still used today in different places as pack animals, right? Because they bear the burdens of the load on the donkey's back. And so as I think about that, and John 1:29 again, when John saw Jesus coming to his baptism, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world," meaning that he will bear the sins of the world. Jesus came to bear the sin of the world. He came to bear my sin. He came to take the burden that is so heavy and loaded upon our lives off by going to the cross and dying so that we might have life and have it much more abundantly. And so when you think about that donkey and Jesus sitting on that donkey, that humble donkey, he was the servant king. But thirdly, he's also the miracle king. He is the miracle king. And Brother Mark talked about this also in our Sunday school class. The donkey was a donkey that never had been ridden before. He had never been ridden before. I actually looked up a YouTube video on how to break a donkey. And I don't know much about any of that in horses. And I looked some of that up, and boy, there's a bit long process in getting a donkey or a horse to the point that you can sit on one. And I got a great example of that. When I was a boy, my grandpa had a farm, and he had a place, the cattle pen, where he brought in the cows that he was going to fatten up to kill. And he had two or three in there. Me and my buddy were up there hanging around, and I dared my friend to see if he could ride one. How many of you have ever tried to ride a little steer or a cow? Huh? Get you in trouble, right? But anyway, I remember him getting down there and getting a good running start and jumping on the back of that steer. And I'm going to tell you, all I did was see him go up and come down. And it was over. And here's my point. Jesus is a miracle king. He has control of all nature. In fact, if you study in the Old Testament, he even had a donkey have a conversation with a human being. And it wasn't Mr. Ed. For you that know, remember the talking horse, Mr. Ed. It wasn't Mr. Ed. And so Jesus has all authority over nature, doesn't he? And he can control the animals. He can control the beast. The only one that he can't control is man. Because he's the only one that's got a sin nature. Am I right? And we need somebody to take control of our lives. And I'm here to tell you, the one that can take control of our lives, that can help us and to break us and to mold us into something that's useful and good, is Jesus Christ. He's the one that can do that in our lives. And the truth is, sometimes we're just stubborn, like the donkey, like the mule. But my Lord can break even the most stubbornest person and help them to see that they need him in their life. And so he's the miracle king. Also, he is the peaceful king. And what I mean by that, when a king would ride into a city after a great victory of war, the kings would ride on stallions, steeds. And that would be a sign that the war was won, that there was victory for the city. But Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. Now, other side of that, when a king was approaching a city and was coming in peace, he would ride a donkey. That was a sign of humility. That was a sign of peace. The Bible teaches us that at one time we were an enemy at war with this king that rode on a donkey because of our sin. And there was a wall of hostility separating us from this King of Peace. And he came, and Jesus came, and he breaks down that wall of hostility so that we can have peace with God. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have what? Peace with God. He was a peaceful king. The king, this king, is a God of peace. And he wants anybody and everybody to be reconciled to him. He wants a relationship with them. And so he came to remove that wall of hostility. And that's what he did on the cross. And now I can come to him by faith, and I no longer am an enemy, and there's no hostility. I am part of his family. I've been accepted and adopted into his family. He wants you, and he wants me in his family, and he wants to be our friend. A lot of people today don't have friends, and they struggle finding good friends. But I'm here to tell you that if you want a friend that'll be closer than any relative, even a brother, Jesus is the friend you need, because he will always be there. Other people will forsake you. Other people will do you wrong, but Jesus will always be there, and he'll always do you and I right. He's a friend that sticks closer than a brother, the Bible says. And out of his love for you, he took action. He took the action of the cross. And so he comes as a God, as a savior, a king of peace in our lives. He wants us to be reconciled to him. And the thing that has separated us from God is sin. The Bible says all of sin, right? And come short of God's glory. But this king comes along, and he comes to bring peace into the hearts of men. Not political peace, not world peace, but peace where it's needed most, in our hearts. A peace that goes beyond the understanding of humanity. A peace that is grander than anything else you can imagine. And that's where people today are today. They're looking for peace, aren't they? They're looking for contentment. Listen to me. It's found in a real, genuine, personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, he's a peaceful king. But lastly, this morning, he's a saving king. Amen? He's a saving king. When he came into to Jerusalem, they cried out saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And the word Hosanna means save now, save now. And so the people were crying out and waving branches with leaves on them and laid them on the ground as Jesus came in on donkey, crying out and saying, "Save now, save now, save now." Now, the problem with this group of people was that they were thinking more on the lines of "Save us from the oppression of the Roman government." That was their mindset. Save us in a more political sense. That was what they were thinking, which meant that they did not understand what was really going on. Because Jesus didn't come to save them politically. He didn't come to save them from the Roman government. He came to save them from their sin. He came to save them from that which had separated them from God. And I'm going to tell you, he still does that today. The Bible says there's another thing we ought to cry out. And let me just share that with you. Romans 10:9. If you confess, it means to cry out, to confess to God with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Yeah, you will be saved. You'll be saved from sin. You'll be saved from the power of sin in your life, because now you have the power of Jesus in your life. And it saves you from your sin. And oh, today, how people need to cry out. Not save us from Joe Biden or whoever else you want to put in that category. But we need to cry out, "Lord, save us from our sin. would save us from our sin. That's what our country needs. It needs Jesus. And so Jesus, the King, rides into Jerusalem on a donkey. Jesus did not come to save them from Rome, but from sin. The King on a donkey. Just hard to imagine, isn't it? The King of the universe riding on a humble donkey. But there's significance to that, isn't there? But I want to hear to tell you something. There's coming a time where he told us, he said, I'm coming back again. And when he comes back this second time, he's not going to be riding a donkey. He's going to be riding a white horse, a stallion, a steed. Because this time he's not coming to go get on a cross and die for the sins of the world. When he comes this time, he's coming in complete and total and absolute victory of all the enemies of death and all of the sin in the world. He's coming in triumphant to us. He's coming back for us. And so he's going to come again. But in this particular context, I think we do see the King on a donkey, and he's a prophetic king. He's a servant king. He's a miracle king. He's a peaceful king. And amen, he's a saving king. And if you're not saved, he wants to save you today. Lord, thank you for the privilege to be here today. Thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, that you speak to us as only you can speak to us through your inspired, infallible word. Lord, we look this morning at the King of the universe. We've looked at you coming on a donkey. And Lord, the significance of that. But Lord, we know one day you're going to be coming in total triumph and total victory. Lord, help us to see you as that humble, peaceful, miracle, prophetic king, that saving king that has come to save the people from their sins. Lord, you haven't come yet, but we know one day you will. And in the meantime, Lord, there's work to be done. And Lord, you've called your people and your church to do the work. Help us, oh God, to do that work before the time runs out. We praise you today. We love you, Lord, and we pray that you bless during this time of invitation. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Maybe you're here today. Let's stand together. Maybe you're here today. You've never come to this King by and trusted him and made him Lord of your life. Look, now's the day. Don't put this thing off. Tomorrow may not be here for you. Make it right today with him. Maybe you're here today and you once were following this King, but now you've got other kings that have taken over and become dominant in your life. Once you come and recommit your life to the real King, the true King, the King that wants to be King of your life, why don't you do that today as we sing? There's room for you. Room for everybody. Thank you so much for being here this morning, and what a great job our young people did in our program this morning. Thank you so much. Don't forget, tonight we won't be having a regular service, but we will. We're going to go to Oakland Baptist, that's in Corinth, and we're going to leave at 5:30. And we need you to be here a little before 5:30 because we need to get on up there because the program is so good that the program doesn't start at 7, but if you don't get there by around 6 or a little after 6, there's not going to be any seats. So be here at 5:30 if you want to ride on the van, okay? Ready to go. Keep that in mind. Any other announcements? Thank you so much for being here. Let's give the Lord Jesus a hand. Consider yourself dismissed.
Mm-hmm.